We now begin with our first session in the after tea segment. I'd like to call our speakers onto stage. Coming Out is the name of the session, and this session features Sandip Roy, Philip Hensher, Living Smile Vidya, who will be in conversation with Manil Suri. Do please join me in welcoming them onto the stage.
And so we didn't really, I had a list of things that I thought I would go over and so on, but then I was told, let's not discuss this at all and let's try to make this as natural and spontaneous as possible. And instead of me actually introducing people, I'm going to actually ask each of the panelists to say why they think they've been included in this panel. Okay, so you know, this panel is roughly about LGBT issues and so on. So, do you want to start, Philip?
I don't know really. I suppose, it's kind of, the title of the panel is Coming Out, and I don't think I'm really much of an expert on that because I came out in 1982 before it even had a name, really. But since then, I've written some books, and I've been in I've been in the newspaper, and I don't know. Well, things have changed in Britain so much that the newspaper the Independent started this campaign really to make gay people more visible in 2000, and they decided to publish a list of the most distinguished gay people in Britain. This is only 15 years ago, and 15 years ago they could only find 50 people who were prepared to put their name forward. About 12 years later, quite a lot of the people who were in 2000 threatening to sue the Independent if their names were included were now phoning up and begging to be included in this now celebrated list. Anyway, I was on the list in 2000, so I was distinguished in 2000, but I sort of became less distinguished over time as people came out.
Sandeep?
I have no idea why I'm on this panel.
Oh, I do.
I'm an interloper.
Not
that way, that way.
I guess, you know, I am only one book old. I've written one novel called Don't Let Him Know, which just came out last year, and which does deal with the issue of sexuality in terms of as a hidden secret in the lives of the characters. But it's an issue that I have felt strongly and written about. I was involved for many years as the editor of Trikon, which was the oldest South Asian LGBT magazine, and it started in the US. It was actually started by these software engineers in the US. And though it was called South Asian LGBT magazine, we used to joke that it was really a magazine for gay Indian computer science engineers, which is what it essentially was. And in fact, the magazine Trikon was initially photocopied at night on Hewlett-Packard's copy machines, because that's where one of the people who started it worked. So to this day, Hewlett-Packard has no idea that they played this very pivotal and important role in the LGBT movement. But I was so involved with that group. It was a group through how I came out myself. So I came out as an, you know, activist. I don't know what you would call it, but as somebody writing about these issues and caring long before I wrote a novel that was based on it. So I assume at some level, it is both of those things are part of my being present on the panel today.
That's great.
Yeah. I'm the good Indian boy gone wrong, or whatever.
Okay. That is. Or the good Indian boy gone right, I don't know. So, Vidya, how about yourself?
So you know the answer that I don't know, actually. Because at least we have two authors, writers here, but I don't consider myself as a writer, actually.
Well, but you have written a book, so So you are a writer, so.
Yeah, that is an autobiography. That was like 8 years before, and then after 8 years, I haven't really wrote a book or something, but maybe the question is supposed to be asked to the committee of Hindu, but at times also, I feel like if I have to be more assertive about my work, then I can tell that here and there I write some articles, and most of them are published in Hindu actually. That is really good. And maybe there is nobody who writes from trans community, especially right. from trans women community, and there are very, very few from Tamil Nadu. So, and when I write this autobiography, it was the first autobiography by any trans woman in India. So, and it got translated into a couple of languages, and there was a film made after the autobiography, and the actor got Best Actor Award.
Did you yes. like the film?
I can't say, you can't.
Yes, sure.
Yes, I like, and I have like some questions, but yes. Right.
Yeah, well, I've read part of the book. I mean, I just started it, and it was really very affecting and very, you know, it just seemed very honest. So, and that's the first time I'd read something like that, especially your scenes of the transition and so on. They were quite, powerful, I thought. So certainly you are a writer as far as I can see. So, it's great to have you all here. And I'll just add why I'm here. I've also been writing about LGBT issues. I've written a book. My last novel had a gay Muslim character in it, I've been writing a few things in newspapers like the New York Times about gay issues. I think one of the key things in India, though, is as Philip was saying, there's a big difference now, it seems, between what's happening in different parts of the world. And I like to think of it perhaps as three different categories. There's the West that's very liberal now with gay marriage and so on, possible. Then there is countries like India, which I think are sort of in between. And then there are countries that have sort of almost regressed. And you find that a lot in some African countries, some Muslim countries, and so on. And also in the USSR, I mean, the former Soviet Union. So India itself seems to be somewhere in the middle, like seems to be going up and down. And that's a very interesting aspect. So I wonder if any of you would like to comment on that aspect. Actually, I'm gonna actually ask the audience a few questions first. I mean, clearly we all identify as LGBT people. How many people in the audience have a close friend or a family member whom they would say is LGBT? Could you raise your hands? Okay. So most people do have a close friend or family member. And now I'm going to ask, how many of you would personally identify as LGBT? Okay, so that's great. You know, people are willing to do that in public, and that's wonderful. You know, that's one of the key things I think that was instrumental in the West to have that kind of visibility. So I thought we'd start by maybe talking about this coming out process where, wherever you were when you started, you're now at a stage, some of us are at a stage where we can raise our hands in public and say, we are LGBT. Philip, do you want to start and say how that progress, what your evolution was?
Well, I think the one of the telling moments, it sounds like a facetious moment, but I thought about it for years afterwards. I was going to see Quentin Crisp, the great visible gay man, who was obviously conspicuously gay presence in English culture from the 1920s onwards, lived a very difficult life in lots of ways. And towards the end of his life, he had a sort of revival as a sort of cabaret performer. And I went to see him in Cambridge. and he answered questions from the audience in the second half of his show. And if you were too shy to put your hand up and ask a question to Quentin Crisp, you could pass a piece of paper to the ushers, and they would bring it up, and he would read it out and then answer it. And one of the questions handed up in this way was, should I tell my mother that I'm gay? And Quentin Crisp, I'm going to do my impersonation of Quentin Crisp, he had an extraordinary voice. He said, never tell your mother anything. But then he went on in this wonderful way. But then he said, at the end, the thing that I went on thinking about for years, he got a huge laugh, but I still think it's true. He said, by the way, if you're over 30, she knows. And I really thought then, and I go on thinking, that there is no closet. If somebody says to somebody, what's your domestic arrangements? And they say, actually, I prefer to keep that to myself. That's a private matter. Then anybody who hears that will say, oh, okay, you're gay. Because, you know, there is no heterosexual in the world that keeps their domestic arrangements to themselves. To insist on privacy in that matter, it's an unachievable ideal. So everybody, probably everybody over 30 who believes themselves in the closet, they are surrounded by a social circle, by employers, by people who sell them their milk in the morning. Every single one of them knows that they are gay. Now, why surround yourself with people who are, at some level, I'm sorry to say this, are probably laughing at you a little bit? So at that point, I was 17, I thought, well, I don't really have enough energy to keep this up, so I just came out, and really it's been great improvement ever since. And I think everybody in the West who has come out has gone on that journey to the point where a lot of us actually started to think that maybe being gay is not that interesting a subject to talk about. It's a bit, and in 50 years' time, maybe we won't be having panels like this in the way that we wouldn't be having panels about what it's like to be left-handed or something like that, I guess.
Yeah, I think so.
Your story, Phil, reminded me about if you're over 30, they know. It reminded me actually of the flip side of it. When I lived in San Francisco, I had a friend, an Asian American guy, who lived in the Castro, which is sort of the gay area of San Francisco. He was not married, but he actually was not gay. But at one point he realized he would keep trying to go out on dates with women, and they would insist on going to brunch with him. He could never go on a dinner date, get any of them to go on a dinner date. And eventually he said, why won't you go on a dinner date with me? And she said, but you're gay. Don't the gays love to do brunch? And he was like, I'm not gay. He's like, but you know, you're over 30. You live in the Castro. How am I supposed to know? So at some level, these assumptions that we carry about thing, it can cut both ways. But to come to my story, I mean, it's a very conventional story in that sense. I came out because I really had no choice to. I was getting close to that 30, the issues of marriage and all of those things would come up. And very importantly, at that time, I felt reasonably independent financially enough so that, you know, I was not afraid of being rejected by my family in sort of the stereotypical idea that we have of the West. You know, you come out and you buy a one-way ticket on a Greyhound bus in America and you go to New York or San Francisco from whatever small town you were. I was afraid of hurting my family. That was why I couldn't come out, because I didn't know, you know, because I at that time lived abroad. I was not facing the question about why aren't you married. My mother was. You know, she's the one who would have to go to the family wedding and say, when are we coming to your son's wedding? And she was the one who was going to have to make up a story. So that was sort of my concern. And when I eventually came out, And I've said this before in other settings, but it bears repeating, that in India, it's like when you come out, the whole family goes into the closet with you. So it just becomes a very large closet. And so then the whole issue becomes about, acha, don't tell that person, don't tell that aunt, don't tell, you know, who you tell and who you don't tell. And that's how the world gets divided, who knows and who doesn't know. And then after a while, you just stop caring because you can't keep track anymore. And it's interesting, even now, you know, when you write a book, and you've experienced the same thing, Manil, you write a book, you know, with a gay character. In any other aspect that you have in your book, in an interview or thing, people will always try to map your real life to your book. It's a common interview thing. Oh, so did you have experience? Did you know much about the Naxalites of Bengal? Is that, did your family, was you affected by it? But this is an area people are still sort of squeamish about. So you can have like four gay characters in your book, but very few interviewers will come out and say, so are you? Because that's where people get nervous.
Yeah. And Vidya, how about you?
It's like you said, family is one of my problem actually. But before that, it is really a big challenge for myself to understand that I am trans. In fact, from my childhood, I never thought I would be I am a trans, because I've seen in films, even I made fun of them. Like I laughed at some people, but always I thought like you know, from my memories, like I always believed that I am a woman, but except nobody sees me as a woman, or it could be the other way around, that everyone sees me as a man, but I don't understand that. I didn't understand that, but this is a huge confusion, and it was like, I don't know, at some time, like, I used to be very religious, and I, like, each night I pray, God, like, something wrong with me, please correct me, I'm so sorry, I'm making a sin, or something like that. And then, in my teenage, like anyone's, the hormone works, you look for a man, you like, you know, you get attracted to men and everything. But mostly, that lead me to, at some point, to an NGO that works for gays, and, like, I had this feeling, maybe I'm a gay, and I was still not happy, or like, I am still not understood that I could be a gay, because I always, no, but I never want to be a man in any way. But there was the time I get a chance to see some trans as well. And I was still like, oh, they're trans, but I'm just, it's like, you know, like a push and pull to talk to them. And at, you know, at one point when I talk to them, like then I became friend, and then again I can realize, I can see, yes, it's me. Like they have the same desire, the same stories, the same childhood, the pain, everything is more or less similar with me. I mean, and then, okay, yes, at some point I have to see it, yes, I am maybe a trans, but as soon as I realize, or as soon as I confront that, I was really in a shock that I can't be, because my first problem is, like you said, my parents, my family, like, because my father is especially whom, and my family, like, they were just, like, they had, like, five daughters, and they were expecting each time a son, and I was the sixth son, and they were, like, they have this hope on me that I'd be the one super masculine something, and I was, like, ayo, how can I even tell them, like, how they're going to, like, or how I'm going to take it, or, like, you know, and they were, like, and especially my father, he's like, I want to be a collector in any time soon, and I have to, you know, take care of the family as a man. And how can I even tell him? Like, that's the biggest thing I'm battling with. But that was the time I also started doing theater during my master's. So I was kind of reading, and theater was somehow that really helped me to calm for a while. After my master's, I really don't know what I'm going to do. I just applied for PhD, but I really don't know what I'm going to do. And I have to, at some point, do something about my battle. And I thought maybe I can end my life by committing a suicide or something. Mm. But I thought, like, okay, anyway, you're going to die. So let's just try once as a woman, and then you feel happy, like, you know, because all my childhood is really horrible, my teenage, everything is horrible. It's like a nightmare. So I want to live happily, and I just try my best, and I'm still not commit suicide because I'm still not happy, maybe. Still working on the process.
Yeah, I think family especially, yes, it's a very, and you know, a lot of this is in her book, so I would really urge people to read your book, because I mean, well, you've really brought out the conflict with your father and everything very well in there. And you know, family is such a big issue in India especially, I think, that, you know, khandan ki izzat and all that, you know, all the Hindi movies and everything, that's such a key thing, as you pointed out too, like, you can't tell anyone, okay, tell me, like my mother, when I told her, she said, don't tell your father. So I didn't tell him for a long time. In fact, we only had that conversation a few months before he died. But interestingly enough, I was in Delhi just now, just before here, and I met my uncle, who's now 84. He's the last surviving uncle. So he was asking, you know, I said, I'm here with my friend. And then I said, no, my partner. And he said, yes, yes, I know. So he said he knows. And then he said, just as a friend, what do you do exactly? So then he wanted to find out what I did, you know, and is it like, are you male, are you female, or do you just take turns? So, you know, that's one of the questions. And then he went on, and he really wanted to know. And then he said, well, what about lesbians? What do they do? And so I found myself really trying to explain all these things, which, you know, when I was growing up, there was really nothing in the newspapers about that. So he is an even older generation. So I feel that there's really a lot of knowledge out there that people just don't know. It's just not visible. And it comes, it always seems to come back to that word, visibility. I think that's one of the reasons things have progressed so well in the US. And it has been a long struggle there, but it's the visibility that counts. So I'm gonna ask.
Wait, before you go ahead. Just reminded me of a quick anecdote with your uncle's story about wanting to know what you do. This happened to a friend of mine in the US who lived with his partner for a long time, and both of them Indian, and then the mother was visiting. And the mother was obviously not as able to ask as directly that same question that your uncle had, but she obviously was very curious to know what they did. So eventually her way of asking it was, she said, so who does the dishes in your house?
Yeah, so family...
And to confuse matters, he said, well, sometimes I do, sometimes he does.
So I think family is a big issue, maybe the biggest issue. But then I want to also ask about what happens after that. I mean, I found that at least with myself, the family was, you know, over a few years, but then it took me a long time to actually come out at work. I work as a professor. And I think the last step for me was to try and come out to students. So I want to ask about, you know, that aspect, like in a professional setting, especially in India. I think that's one of the key points here, like one of the dangers perhaps. I don't know if any of us have any experiences that we'd like to share about that, like coming out in a professional setting.
I think this is the very, very difficult one, because people cling on to their professions. They value them enormously, but because there is this separation between public and private existence, it seems to make sense that you could keep your private life completely separate from what you do during the day at the office. So that can go on for a very long time, I think. There's also the point that if there is discrimination at work, it is sensible to be afraid of it. And discrimination might emerge in quite understated ways. For instance, I used to work at a university in the west of England called Exeter University, and every time we had a faculty meeting, whenever I or the other gay member of the faculty made any kind of point, then everybody would laugh, and then they'd move on to the next thing. I really had the experience that many professional women have of having spoken, having to say, excuse me, I did actually say something. And so it was difficult to say, it would be difficult to say to somebody in that circumstance, somebody coming into it as a junior, you should definitely come out in these circumstances. The only thing that I can say to people who find themselves working in a professional setting where it's evidently difficult is leave. Go and get another job. You know, if they can't treat a significant able minority well, then they're going to be hemorrhaging talent. And I made absolutely sure when I left Exeter University that I wrote the kind of articles in the press about my experience that meant that no talented gay person would ever go and work in that hellhole ever again. That's all that we can do as gay people, in my view.
Sandip, have you?
I have a, like, you know, other people have gayness as a secret. My secret is that even though I'm here invited to LitFest as a writer, I'm actually a computer science engineer, nerd, programmer. And so that was sort of the guiltier secret. So my world, I say this because, so my worlds have always been very sort of separated worlds. You know, I had that computer science programmer world that I lived in which the gayness was not discussed. I was an immigrant in America, so I had gay South Asian friend circle. Then I had the sort of the Indian auntie circle. So you were constantly checking one identity at the door and going into whatever the party was. Because in the end, as people, you know, we need our sustenance from all these different angles. You know, we need that familial feeling and that warmth. Then we also need to go to the bar or wherever we are going and the professional setting. And it is really hard when many people take the fact that those worlds seamlessly flow into each other for granted. And many of us who are gay cannot. And in a way, it's often harder because unlike, say, race or something, people who are gay can pass in those other worlds. So you can often be just think that just by keeping quiet. And it will mean that in a professional setting, even if it's not anything overtly homophobic or anything, if you're not out, it means that if somebody makes that anti-gay joke in front of you, it is becomes that moment of decision for you as to whether you're going to speak up or bite your tongue. And that moment will pass unnoticed by everybody else. But no matter which of those two options you do, you know, you will rankle and wonder, oh, should I have spoken up? Or you'll wonder, otherwise, maybe I should have just kept my mouth shut and gone on. So these kinds of little challenges go on all the time. And it's not just the professional setting. I mean, in India, the biggest thing is not really about being gay or not, it's about being married or not. And so as somebody, you know, we need more Quentin Crisps coming and telling this of you. But, this is also an old story that I've told before. When I came back to India from the US, I was getting my house flat in order, and I was trying to get a modular kitchen design. And I went to the modular kitchen design place, you know, and they're saying, like, acha, these cabinets, these shelves and everything. I approved the design, and the guy looks at me and says, okay, so, you know, when will madam come and approve it? And I'm like, no, there's no madam going to approve it. I'm going to approve my own modular kitchen. And the guy was like, no, we can wait a few days for madam to come and approve it. And it was the moment when you realize that, I don't know what he was more shocked by, that there was no madam, or that a man without a madam might even want a modular kitchen in his house. But it is those moments where you feel like, you know, that coming out becomes an endless process. And in that case, I chose not to come out in that sense. I just said that, no matter. Yeah.
So actually, I'm going to ask the same question of you in a slightly different form, because one thing that Sandip said was that being gay is something that you can hide. And in some sense, is that something that, what has your been experience with either passing as a woman or a transgender person, like in your day-to-day life, in your work and so on? How does that play a role?
It's a long story, actually. So, see, I have to tell you this. From my childhood, my dream job is like, I want to be an actress, even before I realize I'm a woman or trans, but I just want to be an actress for one reason, that every Diwali or New Year, there is these heroines give special interviews on this festival times. I just want to be given festival time interview like that, and I want to be an actress, and that's how I come to know about theatre and everything. But when I realized I'm trans, and when I need to do this surgery, so when I went to Pune, I used to be a small-time beggar in trains, and that is the only one job I never felt discriminated. But all the others, I tried to, you know, because by the time there is the only two jobs available for trans women in India is begging or sex work. And I chose the safer one, begging. But after the surgery, and I have to still continue begging, that is not my life. My life is something bigger. I just still want to give the interview in Diwali. So I was just, I came back, but it was shocking because the groups, those two, three groups I worked with the previous male identity, they accept me. They didn't say like, oh, how you can't be something like that. But they accept me, but they really don't know how to handle me. I mean, they were still like, they were confused, like, what I'm like, if am I still a boy or like a boy in a girl's dress or a woman. They don't really know how to handle me, to accept me or something. And that is my big hope, actually speaking. I'm going back as a woman. I'll start doing theater immediately and I'll be like a star immediately anytime soon, but it didn't happen. But for 2 years, then I have to find some other opportunity. So I tried to find a job. In the beginning, I tried to even work in NGOs, which works for others. But is everything like, they said, like, yeah, I mean, we are okay to have you. We're worried about our colleagues. I mean, they might say something and blah, 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 like that. And then at some point, I even let's forget these NGOs at all. Let's just try something even more mainstream, some companies. And it was like most of them, like, again, they tried to accept me, but still my name, my documents, everything is in a different name with a different gender. So, which I have to fight. So there was this one company, and they accept me, and they give me a job with the previous name, Akka Vidya now. And then the gender was not in the identity, they didn't mention my gender or something. They gave me a job, but that triggered me to change my name and my gender in legally. So when I applied for that, that's how I realized that I am the one first trans woman who is working in mainstream. Because before that, there are a few people who are like a small vendors, like flowers, selling flowers or selling idlis or something, but like a job, as a first. But still, there's so many practical issues. Then I have to change my name, and it took me like two and a half years. But still, after I change everything, but still, that is not my dream yet. So I have to come back, and thanks to Mange and people like her. So they took me and this book, actually speaking, maybe that's why I'm here, because the book gave me an identity, that autobiography. So now people know me, then there are people ready to accept me their work. And now, but still, sure. I feel like sometimes, but I'm successfully in theater for like 9 years. Mm-hmm. But if you ask me now, I feel more minority being a theater artist than a trans.
Ah, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, one of the things that I like to say is that, you know, we all live in different worlds, and we are all minorities in some way or the other. Like, for example, for myself, you know, I live in the US, but I'm from India, so that's one kind of minority. I live in a straight world, but I'm gay, so that's another kind. And I think the most odd one, like what you said, is I'm a mathematician in a non-mathematical world. So that's maybe the worst minority to be in. And interestingly enough, what you said about computer scientists, for the last book, The City of Devi, I went to this industry, SAP, SAP Industries. So they sometimes have authors come in and talk to their workers to just bring in cultural stuff and so on. So the person who was interviewing me kept saying, you know, people like yourself, or, you know, the kind of things that you do, or something like that. And I finally said, okay, you have to say the word homosexual. So then each time he stopped saying that, I made him say that. And then I said to everyone, okay, each time he says it, I want you all to applaud. So, you know, I forced him to say it. Just because you don't hear these words, everyone is so shy and so on. So that's, again, the visibility question. One thing I'm wondering, though, is, and I hear this a lot, and I don't spend enough time in India to know that, but the question is, I keep hearing that the younger generation is quite okay, or they're much more liberal, they're seeing things on the internet and so on, and so they're much more attuned to these issues. Anyone want to comment on that? In India, I'm talking about. I mean, in the US, of course, and in the West and in England, yes. How about in India?
Well, it is true. I mean, you can't make any huge sweeping generalization, of course, but I can see that my nephew and niece and their friends have a whole different attitude towards it, because it's not because they know that many people necessarily who are gay or lesbian, but it is part of the discourse in a way that it wasn't in our growing up. Our growing up in paper, gay issues meant Rock Hudson dying of AIDS. You know, that is how gay issues came into our papers. And also it was even the coverage that happened in India, there was like always a set, you know, every couple of years, a newspaper would do a story on the gay Indian, and it would always have an interview with Ashok Rao Kavi, because he was the only one who would give interviews, and with Sylvie, the hairdresser, because that was the only other person. Then there would be some interviews with a psychiatrist or someone, a few pictures which would always be in silhouette. And, you know, it was the same story that was being done over and over again. That has changed now. So there are people, you know, so you can be reading a story about a chef, and then at some point in the story you suddenly figure out that the chef is gay, but the gayness of the chef is not the story anymore. So they are much more used to it, but it comes with a price, Manil, because at some level you also don't have to think about it in a way as you might have had to, where, you know, I have had friends, I'll give you one quick example. When I came out to my two best friends in school that I'd grown up with. One of them accepted it instantly, like, oh, okay, yeah, whatever. The other one actually had a really hard time with it, and he didn't reply. Those days to write letters to come out. And he read the letter, he didn't reply for days, and he said he had a really hard time trying to put this aspect of myself together with the one he knew. But in the end, once he went through that hard process, he's far more accepting about it than the person who quickly said, it doesn't matter at all to me, because at some level he had to tussle with it.
Okay. I'm going to actually start asking questions from the audience, and then, you know, we can all chime in. So I don't know if there's a mic around, or if people just want to... There's a couple of people in the back who would like to ask questions. Is there a microphone? Okay. Oh.
Can I just, while we're waiting, can I just share a moment from recent history that just shows that it's not just in India that these profiles were taking place. About 12 or 13 years ago, The Observer newspaper, traditional liberal newspapers phoned me up and said they were commissioning a feature about coming out, and they were going to get five people to tell their own stories in their own words about what it was like to come out, and would I like to write an introduction to the whole thing. So anyway, I said yes, I'd be delighted to. Wrote an introduction to the whole thing. The newspaper came out, And there were indeed five stories from people. John, 23, London. And at the end, there was a little note saying, all names have been changed. And I thought, really, if your assumption is that you can't find five LGBT people in London in the year 2002 prepared to tell their own stories under their own names, then that's really your problem. There really is. So these things, they are changing, but they're changing. They've been changing quite recently, I think we'll have to say.
Yeah. And I think in India, especially with Section 377 looming over everything, it becomes even harder to do some of those things. There was a question somewhere in the back that somebody raised their hand. Yes. I don't think the mic is working.
Hi.
Hello.
So, the main reason why members of the LGBT community are terrified of coming out is not because they are ashamed, but because they are scared of what the people around them would tell. So, whether their opinions of that particular person might change. My question is, where did this prejudice begin in the first place? As in, you can't say it's against nature. If it was against nature, nature wouldn't have allowed this to happen. So, where did this all begin and why does it still exist? The prejudice against the
sure.
LGBT.
Right. I think we actually have someone from the British Empire who can tell us why we have Section 377.
Yes. We invented it. I don't know. Well, my general view is if you're surrounded by people who are going to disapprove of the announcement that you are who you are, then you probably need to change your environment. I don't know. That's a strange one. So, what imperial crime am I taking responsibility for?
Well, it is interesting that Section 377, actually the same number exists in different countries. Like
yep.
Singapore has a Section 377. And you know, it's always a law against sodomy usually.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I think there's some fact that most countries that now have laws against against sodomy, so-called, they are former countries of the British Empire. It's kind of their responsibility now. We had a law against it until 1967.
I
take responsibility. What can I say?
No.
I would also say that while it's always really good fun to blame the British for everything. It is also true that, you know, the British left in 1947 and we chose to keep that in our constitution. So we chose to do this.
Yeah.
And to get your question back about where does prejudice come from, in the end, we are terribly conforming creatures. We want to conform to what people expect of us all around. And if by being gay or by being different in many ways, divorce, whatever, when you choose not to conform to what people expect of you, there is unhappiness around you and there is that prejudice comes out.
But also, you know, and this Devdutt Patnaik has written about it and several other scholars have written about it, how in Hinduism there are ancient texts, like even the Kama Sutra, that talks about gay sex between men. Even the laws of Manu, the penalty for having gay sex is like you take a ritual bath. So, I mean, it's very little compared to some other things that can have you put to death. So, traditionally in India, there was not necessarily that shamefulness associated with it. So that's an interesting thing. But I want to go on to another question. There's a mic here somewhere.
Hi. So, my question is, see, over the last few years, the visibility of LGBT people is like increased. You see pride marches happening in most metros in this country. you see a lot of prominent people coming out and things like that. Why is it that Section 377 is still being upheld? Why is it that people are not, why are people so homophobic in this country? I mean, I'm not understanding, especially with the rise of this community and with people willing to come out and willing to accept their identity, I just don't understand why the law is not willing to change.
The general answer to your question is that there's never any political capital in abolishing a law like this. You know, the best that even a very well-intentioned government can generally achieve is to let the law quietly pass into disuse, really. This is what happened in Germany, where the Bismarck paragraph 175 went on and on and on, you know, into the 1970s and even 1980s, but it had been years since a prosecution had happened. If you imagine, you know, a busy politician saying, "Well, what should we do today? I tell you what, should we cause outrage in the newspapers by giving rights to some this class of society that many people seem to express hatred and loathing towards, or should we just keep it a little bit quiet and just forget about it altogether?" You can see that from a practical point of view. I mean, it's clearly the right thing to do, but it's sometimes a long time coming.
Yeah. And in fact, Shashi Tharoor, who is here at the festival, did try to introduce a private member's bill on 377 in Parliament and didn't even get to discussion because people didn't want to talk about it, and the party and a lot of the other MPs just walked out of Parliament so that they would not be forced to vote on this issue. And there was a lot of snickering and comments about that. But in terms of your comment, the law is upheld because it did go away, but then it came back. And I think it was a bit of a luck of the draw that those particular judges of the Supreme Court were the ones chosen to. If it had been another couple of different set of judges, it may have been a different story. But what was interesting was the uproar when that Section 377 was reinstated was so huge. I think it did take people in the political class by some surprise that this issue could actually cause that much of a ruckus.
And just to add to what both of you have said, if you look at the history in the US, the Stonewall riots occurred in 69. The Supreme Court actually upheld the anti-sodomy laws in the 80s, and it was only in the early 2000s that it was finally overturned. So there was a 26-year battle to actually change things.
As much as it is heartening to see my dear friend Vidya on stage, as much as it is heartening to see my dear friend Vidya on stage, it is equally disheartening to hear her stories and struggles, you know. I'm not raising a question here exactly, but I'm just trying to share my concern. Compared with LGBTs, the problem of transgenders are more in terms of, you know, they're more vulnerable to the society's taboos and the struggles, what they face, and it's very obvious. So in the order LGBT, why don't we place the alphabet T in the beginning, because their problems are more to be addressed with, you know, if you understand what I mean. Like, as I said, instead of phrasing it LGBT, why don't we give more vital importance to, you know, the alphabet T to start with? Like, any counter arguments or anything?
Well, one thing that I will say, and I'll come to you, but certainly the New York Times has been it has a special several months worth of just transgender issues. So it's really been pushing that. So if you read the New York Times, you really see that. But that doesn't affect India, so maybe you can address that.
Yeah, but thanks, Vilasini, but you're right. I mean, yes, we do have even more issues, even more challenges to lead our life with the dignity and everything. And for example, like I said, yes, of course, gay and lesbian have issues, and especially in 377 and everything. But for us, the very basic need, like economic and social, cultural rights, everything is in even more challenging place. But the question is about like why it's not more important given to trans in this, then I don't know, because we are slowly getting the space maybe, and that's why I'm here. So maybe we can expect from, you know, well, next year or something, maybe there could be a session especially for trans. I don't know. But so yes, I agree with your question.
This is about two things. One is about the prejudice and 377 being slammed and then brought back and then slammed, goes on. I think every society, every organized space works, thrives on taboos. And this is one of the taboos because they are scared about freedom. That's primarily the reason. How else one can explain it? Other is, this is a little, I don't know how to even phrase my question, but I'm really, if I can't use this space, it was wonderful listening to all of you, first of all, the sharing that you did here. In a way, I can come closer to understanding what is the greatest fragile, tragic moment for a trans woman, perhaps. It's about what happens when in a space where she's sensually evoked by a man, and what happens between them when he's accepting or when he's responding or not. What is the most fragile area in a gay relationship? Because I don't know that.
Okay, well.
If it is possible to respond.
Would either of you like to respond? What is the most fragile point in a gay relationship?
Well, I think it depends on the relationship, really. I think it's a difficult one.
I think maybe what you meant is the most important part of the evolution of becoming gay. Maybe that's what you meant more than.
Well, there is a fragility which I think is true of any, you know, in any relationship when you get attracted to somebody, you don't know if it's reciprocated at that moment, right? Whether that person is interested in you in the way that you are. With gay people, you know, you often deal with the fragility of an attraction to someone whose sexuality you're not aware, you know, you're not sure about. And so you don't know if you're going to get punched in the face for exposing a certain vulnerability about that to that person. And in the end, I think for all of us, you know, irrespective of sexuality, when it comes to relationships, our greatest fragility is that fear of rejection. And that rejection, whether it is by your mother because you told her, or a lover, or somebody that you were attracted to on a bus, and that summoning up of courage that you have to do in order to tell that person this one scary, vulnerable truth about yourself, and not know whether what the repercussions of saying that will be. It's a heart-stopping moment for everyone.
I think we have time for just one last question.
I have a question.
Can I just respond to this question?
Sure, sure.
Thank you for asking this question, because this is something I really like. This is one of my biggest struggle to find a partner for my life in terms of sex or in terms of leading a life together. Because most of the time, because I have a very, very sad stories in terms of love and making love. Because when a man expects me, because he most of the time he sees me as a woman, and that's what I even tell him. But when it comes to a sexual life, this is something really hard, that he was expecting something and I can't give something. For example, when he was, maybe because there are some moments like I really like desperately in love with somebody, and the very moment when it happens and he asked me to just, you know, just say suck it or something like that, I feel like, I mean, it's not offensive, but it makes me feel like I'm not gay, I'm a girl, please, you know? Like that moment I feel really like very small, and I that is the moment I never hate my body, but when it comes to sex, I really feel bad, I really feel small about my body. And that is something really painful, very, very painful. And it's like, this is like, I have like 10 stories like that, and most of them, I believe, most of the trans, I believe that they have this same kind of struggle experience.
I have a question.
We actually haven't, Philip just pointed out, we haven't had a single question from a man. Okay, should we take one from the other sex? Well, one of the other sexes.
Thank you. So in light of Section 377 and the private member amendment that you just mentioned, even if it does get passed by Indian Parliament, do you think that would be sufficient to bring about social acceptance of the LGBT community? In other words, is legal acceptance equal to social acceptance?
No, in a simple word, no, it's not. Legal acceptance is not social acceptance, but none of them are working. But it is a good point to start. I mean, you can't say, let's not do Section 377 because it will not bring social acceptance. But, you know, in the same way as in the US, laws against lynching did not mean attitudes towards African Americans and racism would go away instantly. But as Martin Luther King said, well, at least it stops people from, you know, breaking our bones.
So, yeah, one last word.
There's a wonderful English expression that you used to hear all the time, and I wish you heard it more often by someone who felt they'd been done wrong to, and it's, I know my rights. And you used to hear that on buses and in the streets and everywhere, and that's what the legal change does. It gives people the right, the freedom to say, I know my rights and you can't talk to me like that. And that's it's not just a place to start. I think it's a wonderful place to start with the law on your side.
So Vidya, one last, very quickly, yes.
Yeah. I just want to just add something, like for example, in day-to-day life, you don't try to accept any man or woman or, you know, like, or any straight. You just don't like, oh, you're a man, I accept you. Oh, you're a woman, I accept you. You'd never do that. Like, then why you're expecting that we expect you to accept us? Very simple. Like he said, like rights, we need our rights, and it's like, it's not something we ask something super special than you have. Just we are asking, like, we deserve something and we are lack of that, and we are asking, and that's very simple. And I'm not expecting anyone to accept me ever. I think that's great. Common for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. This was a great session. Thanks to all of you coming, and thanks to all of our panelists.
I thank Hindu Lit Fest because this is my third time participating, and thanks to Prasanna Ramasamy and the whole committee and everybody for the hospitality, everything. Thank you so much. And thank you all. Thank you, my co-panelists.
Big thank you to our speakers. Thank you, Philip, Sandeep, Vidya, and Manil. Thank you very much.